This was Karen's first mistake. Never ever buy cars you see advertised by the roadside, even if they are very shiny. You won't get a warranty and you won't know who you're buying from. It's just too risky. Before she handed over her hard-earned, Karen rang HPI and spent £28.50 checking out the car's history.
Yes, HPI. Hi, can you do a vehicle check for me, please?
They told her that it wasn't stolen or recorded as a write-off, but their record said that it was white, not red. Karen rang Mr. Vickers, who said that the colour confusion was DVLA's mistake on the registration document. Karen took his word and did the deal. That was Karen's second mistake. She was right to ring HPI, but wrong to buy a car with the slightest question mark over its identity. Never buy a car without a V5 registration document, and never take the seller's word for anything.
First thing we did, straight to the petrol station, fill the car with fuel, well, tried filling the car with fuel. It leaked all over the forecourt. There I phoned Mr. Vickers straight away. He said, fair enough, he said, fetch it round and I'll put a new tank on for you. He fixed it for us, well, as we thought was all right, but we noticed on the way home, none of the fuel gauge wouldn't work and the battery light was permanently on. Anyway, the following day was fitting a radio into the car. My brother-in-law pulled up the carpet and found the floor chiselled out where the actual chassis number should be. We then opened the bonnet up and saw that the VIN plate was a false one. And we phoned Mr. Vickers up and told him what we knew. And he says, look, if somebody comes knocking on my door about this car, he says, I won't be a very happy man, if you know what I mean.
No, of course Mr. Vickers didn't want anybody delving too deeply because his 91H Nova was, in point of fact, a 90G. An accident damage write-off rebuilt using the identity from another write-off. Karen was absolutely mortified. In desperation, she rang the trading standards, the RAC, and even the police. But nobody could help her.
I'm still paying for a loan because I borrowed the money for a car I haven't got. I couldn't drive it, they wouldn't MOT it, wouldn't insure it because, I didn't know if it was a H-reg or a G-reg. Couldn't take my children out in it because it was unroadworthy. And I was just fuming. I just felt like I was banging my head against a brick wall. Nobody would help me.
Top Gear has had this Nova inspected by an independent consulting engineer, and the news is grim. As we thought, it's two cars cobbled together into one. It's not a 91H, but a 90G. There's a huge question mark over its identity. And as to the value, it isn't anything like the £3,000 that the Boltons paid for it. Its true value is exactly half that, £1,500. And worse still, because the petrol tank was leaking at the time of sale, it was dangerously unroadworthy. So, essentially, it is a chunk of junk. So we thought we'd better ask Mr. Paul Vickers how he manages to sleep at night. We rang him. We wrote to him. We rang him again, but he declined to be interviewed.
Eventually, we did manage to speak to him on the phone, and he said that he'd sold the Boltons a very, very nice, clean car. And when we asked him about its history, he said, I didn't hide anything. Well, we don't dispute that the car was clean, but Mr. Vickers knew much, much more than he claims about its background. So if Mr. Vickers isn't going to help Karen, who is? Well, Top Gear has spoken to HPI, who offer compensation if their records don't reveal a car's hidden history. They did tell Karen that the car was white, not red, but she chose to ignore that advice. Even so, they've decided to help out and given Karen £3,000 towards another car. Mind you, if she'd spent about £100 on a full inspection in the first place, none of this would have ever happened.
So what about the architect of all this misery, Mr. Vickers? Well, he's allowed to carry on his business dealings undeterred, simply because in this country there is no legal obligation to tell someone that you are selling them a repaired, accident-damaged write-off. What's more, you can start up a car sales scam by the roadside and you don't need any license or legislation. Now, we think that is scandalous. And since the government's talking about morality and having a clean-up, why doesn't someone tell them that there is a huge, steaming, conical pile of filth right here, and it's called the second-hand car market?
I can understand why sport utility vehicles are so popular. They combine chunky, trendy looks with 4x4 practicality and that oh-so-important street cred. 99% of the time, none of these will see any off-road action. These vehicles are very much for the urban jungle. That's why, for the purposes of this test, we're sticking strictly to tarmac. Starting with Toyota, who are first in the game with a trendy RAV4. It may have four-wheel drive, but it's always been considered more GTI than mud plugger with those curvy looks. It comes with three or five doors. Now the competition's hotting up. The CRV is Honda's first European off-roader. The new kid on the block only has part-time four-wheel drive, but is crammed with innovative features. Subarus are better loved by country folk than townies. Fashion is not what the Forester is about. It's more down to earth, but its workmanlike looks belie its off-road pedigree. The first thing that strikes you about the Forester is its long, low estate car looks. I mean, you could best describe, I think, the front as undistinguished. For me, it's too chunky to be a state car, but not high enough or trendy enough to be a four-wheel drive. I suppose you could best describe it as quirky. Some of the features, well, it's got frameless windows, it's got a whole plethora of cubbyholes, 20 in all. The back seats fold down with the head restraints still attached, which is very useful. At the back, it's the only one with a conventional tailgate and also a load cover. More cubbyholes, a power point, and underneath here, your very own black plastic washing up bowl. Now, in all my years of motoring, I've never felt the necessity of one of these, but then perhaps I just don't have that Subaru mindset. So let's see what it's like on the road. Well, the Forester handles much more like a car than a four-wheel drive, hence that you don't get the same amount of body roll. Its flat four engine is unique in its class, and it's great for pulling at low revs, and I find it very refined. It's really, I suppose, a good steady slogger rather than an exciting drive. It's got a separate low ratio gearbox, which means that if the mood takes you, you can go off-road. But obviously with the low ground clearance, there is limited potential for rugged pioneering kind of stuff. The interior is a bit basic and a bit plasticky, and I do find that the switches are really a bit tacky. I suppose the only way to sum up the interior is to say it's pretty undistinguished, really. The thing that drives me really mad, though, is the view from the rearview mirror. Those head restraints just seem to dominate your view. The base model costs $16,400, which seems quite good value. But this one we're driving with all the kit, like side airbags and air conditioning, costs $18,400, which I think seems quite a lot, but maybe Subaru fans will think it's worthwhile.
The CRV is the tallest of the trio, looking spacious on the outside.
And it turns out to be just like that on the inside. Stepping from the Subaru into the Honda is very much more like getting to a four-wheel drive because of the high driving position. In terms of the engine, it's got a gruff 2-litre engine, quite revvy, which I personally found rather rough. And because of the size and height of the vehicle, well, it has got quite a lot of roll, particularly when you go around corners. There's loads of space with a light open cabin and great visibility, which means, of course, it's very easy to park. The interior has been really well put together and all the controls have a good, solid feel to them. And there's some really nice touches like this flip-up table and some very good, useful storage just underneath the dashboard. This really does have the feel of an expensive car. Now, this particular model we're testing is $17,320. And with that, you get alloy wheels, air conditioning and lots of extras. The Honda CRV's looks have grown on me. He's a handsome, rugged sort of a chap. And in fact, very much more an off-roader in terms of shape and height than the Subaru. And it too has lots of interesting features, like, for example, a split tailgate and lots of gadgets.
Like the tailgate power point, which means an optional, albeit cold shower, is always available. Cool drinks too can be on tap with a plug-in fridge. And a fold-out picnic table cunningly hidden in the boot means you can take tea anywhere, bone china not included. It makes the CRV perfect for country or beach, which is probably where the Toyota belongs. It's the oldest design here, but is still considered a hip set of wheels.
I must say, I've always been a fan of the RAV4. In fact, Toyota say that half the owners of the RAV4 are female, and you can see why. It's easy to drive, it's got a good high driving position, but it's not quite as obviously macho as the more traditional off-roader. Like the Subaru, it has permanent four-wheel drive, but lacks its solid feel, and the ride is harsh and noisy. It's certainly more basic than both its competitors. Compared to the Honda, the interior is flimsy and under-equipped, and Toyota appear to agree with us because a major revamp is planned very soon. It'll get air conditioning, ABS, and a bit less plastic. The interior is less spacious and has none of those clever little cubbyholes that the others have, and it certainly doesn't run to either washing up bowl or a shower. This one, pre-revamp, is £17,433. That's £200 more than the Honda. Toyota may have started ahead of the game, but its rivals have caught up with it. I have to say that when I started this road test, I was convinced that I would ultimately make the RAV4 my choice. But having driven all three, if I wanted a trendy off-roader that was easy to live with and that drives like a car, there's no question the Honda wins hands down.
Welcome back. Now you left me fooling around in a Range Rover, using hyperbole to explain that satellite navigation does make mistakes. But as you can see, it will always get you where you want to go.
However, I do think it has problems. First, it's still crushingly expensive. Second, it only works in the southeast, Birmingham and Manchester. And third, it took me unnecessarily to Hillingdon, and that is unforgivable. The upshot is that I can't really recommend it. However, there is something else in this car that I can recommend a lot. In the back of these front headrests, there are two TV sets, and down here, there's a video player. So, you can put Noddy on, wrap the kids up in these remote control headsets, and they'll love you forever. Or, remember I told you at the beginning of the programme that Land Rover had worked out a way to make its customers more popular? Well, these TVs are plainly visible to following traffic, and what I've got here is a copy of Debbie Does Dallas.
You're way ahead of me.
If we haven't completely satisfied your motoring lust, there's more. Some people will do the oddest things to get behind the wheel of a Jaguar E-Type, which is why we've chosen the phallic Jag to kick off a new series of The Car's the Star this Monday, BBC Two, 7:10. Next Thursday, Top Gear is at the London Motor Show, along with a hunky Honda, a chunky Land Rover, and a funky Porsche. Bye-bye.